Let us summarize what we've learned about the conditioning of the linear least squares problem. Okay? We're trying to solve the linear least squares problem. And what we saw was that a relative change in the right-hand side is at most amplified by the condition number of A times this factor 1 divided by the cosine of theta, where theta is the angle between the vector B, the right-hand side, and the column space of A. Okay? So, you know, under the best of circumstances, if the cosine of theta is equal to 1, we're back to a relative error in the right-hand side is at most amplified by the condition number of A. And therefore, if you say start with 8 digits of accuracy in the right-hand side, and you have a condition number of 10 to the 4th, then you would expect to lose 4 digits of accuracy, and you end up with a result that is roughly 4 digits of accuracy. That's the kind of thing that you would expect by virtue of the problem itself, independent of the solution method by which you find the solution. That's the best you can hope for. Or that's, under the worst circumstances, that's the best what you can hope for. All right, now, we have just learned that there is the method of normal equations for solving this. And what does that involve if A has linearly independent columns? Well, that involves instead solving A Hermitian transpose A times X hat is equal to A Hermitian transpose times B. Right, so far so good. Simple problem, simple method. You multiply the right-hand side by this, giving you a new vector, let's call it Y. And then you form this matrix right here, let's call it B. And you solve BX hat is equal to Y. Everything is beautiful. Well, except for the fact that there will be error in Y as well. That error will come in part from the fact that there was an error in the right-hand side delta to B, and in part because in computing this, you may introduce additional error in the computation because of round-off error. And what do we know about how an error in Y might be amplified into an error in X hat? Well, there we know that a change in Y, a relative change in Y, may be amplified by the condition number of A. Of course, it's the condition number relative to the 2 norm now. And that then puts a bound on the relative error in X hat that comes out of this. Now notice that that's... Now, wait a second. That's not matrix A here. That is now matrix B. Okay? And again, the error in Y may be partially due to a propagation of the error in B after you multiply by A Hermitian transpose. And in part, it may be due to errors in the computation. And now we've got a problem. Because you're going to do a homework that shows that the condition number of A Hermitian transpose is equal to the square of the condition number of A. In other words, it's equal to sigma 0 squared divided by sigma n minus 1 squared. What does that mean? Okay, let's say you start with a problem where the error, the relative error, is such that you had 8 digits of accuracy. And let's say that you have a condition number of 10 to the 4th. That 10 to the 4th is now squared. So now you have a 10 to the 8th. That means that you may lose 8 digits of accuracy You started with 8 digits of accuracy. You may have no digits of accuracy left whatsoever. So, as long as the condition number A is small, as long as A has roughly, is not close to a matrix with linearly dependent columns, and as long as you have a decent number of digits of accuracy to start out with in your right-hand side, the method of normal equations is an acceptable way of going about your business. But the instant things get a little tricky, the instant that the condition number of A, wherever it is, right here, gets large, or you didn't have a whole lot of accuracy to start out with, you should not be using the method of normal equations. And I want to point out, this is a consequence of the method we're using to solve the problem, as opposed to a problem inherent in the linear least square problem you're trying to solve. Okay? So, we need to look for better methods.